Deadline, Chapter 4, Early September. Little Wolf, how are you doing this? Coach has called me into his office after practice. This place is a trip through Trout athletic history. There's a framed picture on the wall of Coach and Boomer, Sooner's dad. Man, one look at that guy and you know why Sooner doesn't have siblings. This guy eats his young. That year's quarterback stands between them, for which Coach looks plenty happy. The Idaho State Championship trophy for the 2 mile run sits on a table just below that picture. Then there are a few years missing, followed by paraphernalia highlighting some event in football or track for each year Coach has been back. To the untrained eye, it might look like a storeroom in the back of a sporting goods store, but my eyes trace these walls with reverence. Nobody I know loves what he does more than Coach Lou Banks. How am I doing what? He sweeps his hand, palm down, in front of the window, looking out into the locker room. This, he says, football. You're flattening guys half again your size. Focus, I tell him. I give him my theory on Jim Brown in the path of the rapidly accelerating 123-pound bowling ball. Why? I want to learn to coach it, he says. No offense, but you're not exactly in possession of an NCAA Division I body for any sport. Coach Gildy and I used to sit around after your cross-country meets and laugh our asses off at your turnover rate. Man, you must have worn out some shoes. That's pretty funny. It's all math, I tell him. The shorter the stride, the faster the drumbeat. And how the hell are you getting all these tackles? I've clocked your wind sprints, and you might be the sixth or seventh fastest guy on the team, yet you're in on almost every damn tackle. I'm telling you, Coach, math. You gauge the speed of the guy you're after and chart the angle quick enough to know where he's going to go before he does. Then give him the big surprise. A football field is finite on all sides. The mathematician conquers the speedster almost every time. Coach palms his neck. How do I put that in the language of the average football player? He says. The average football player doesn't speak a language, I say back. And you might notice something else. I may be the sixth or seventh fastest wind sprinter at the beginning, but clock me toward the end. Coach looks wistful. I played like you once, maybe not as smart, but as hard. It's good to have you, Ben. Plus, you keep your brother level-headed. He's quiet a moment. Listen, buddy, these first weeks you're looking tough enough to start. But like you said, you got guys who've been busting their butts for 3 years waiting for that starting spot. Give it to them. Most times that won't be the difference between a win and a loss. When I am, put me in. Otherwise, I'm fine with special teams. I don't want to sound like some kind of saint or something, but if this disease takes me out in mid-season and they're counting on me, it could be hard to fix. And no way do I want anyone hating me for taking a spot. I probably won't be around long enough to fix that. It's good to drum up a little contempt for the guy running ahead of you on the cross-country team, because you both get to run anyway. But you don't want disharmony with your buds on the gridiron. Coach pops me on the top of the head. You're a good man. How's the old pickup running? Running good, I tell him, and I'm getting ready to christen her. Feel free to keep it to yourself when you do, he says. I said before, Coach has long felt like a second dad to me. Coming on to Christmas of Cody's in my eighth grade year, the world was right. Mom was on her meds. We had 3 feet of snow. It was clear and cloudless and Cauldron and Welder's butt in the Klondike, as Dad put it, casting the valley and mountains in heart-stopping postcard beauty. A great hunting season augmented Dad's mail and freight business, and Cody and I brought in extra money of our own, shoveling sidewalks and pushing cars out of ditches. You couldn't have crammed one more present under our tree. Then, around December 20th, Mom flushed her medication down the toilet, and on the 24th, downed close to a fifth of Jim Beam whiskey and turned Christmas Eve into Halloween. The crazy chemical imbalance she achieved would have sent Freddy Krueger running for cover. My mother's shrill, rageful voice echoed through the neighborhood as Coach pulled up to let Cody and me out after caroling up at the county hospital. And through the window, we saw the living room filled with smoke. Coach ran inside to find Dad pinning Mom to the couch and a smoking, water-soaked pile of ashes beneath the tree. Dad had got to her as the fire started up the tree and kept us off the next night's evening news. Coach took Cody and me to his place. We didn't get any presents that year, but we skied and snowmobiled all Christmas Day with Coach before settling down in his tiny dining room for one of the worst turkey dinners I have had the pleasure of choking down. Since then, he's been our go-to guy when the shitstorm starts. Coach probably could have gone anywhere and done anything he wanted, but he came back home. Trout High School stands on the same ground it stood on when he went here more than 25 years ago, though it's been remodeled. Hidden on the south side of the building, there's a tree with a plaque set in concrete near the trunk. It says, "In memory of Becky Sanders." Everyone knows Becky was Coach's girlfriend. She died in that awful accident at the River Bridge south of town. Coach had been the scourge of the school that year after he stomped off the football field when his racist coach had ordered an illegal hit on a black player from another school, the only black player in the league, and Sooner's dad did the dirty deed. That ended Coach's football career. By his own account, he wasn't a particularly talented football player, so he turned himself, on guts alone, into a better small college distance runner than his talent should have allowed. Football was his first love, after Becky, and I think he came back here to get the bad taste out of his mouth from that last year. And he stayed. Now that I know I'm on my way out, I'm worried that he likes me so much with a dead girlfriend in his history. If we win it this year, it will be because of my brother. Physically, he's got it all. We run a single wing, which is like pre-Pleistocene and never seen an 11-man, but it's perfect for a quarterback who's as good a runner as he is a passer, and that's my brother. Even with his dyslexic defensive reading skills, he's almost impossible to corner because of his speed and quick release. He's upchuck scared before every game, dead sure the other team will figure out he's fooling the world, but the second the kickoff whistle blows, he transforms into a football machine. God, I love to watch him play. One thing about attending a high school with fewer than 100 students is you're offered one teacher for each subject, and if you don't get along with him or her, suck it up. It's worse with a required course because, well, it's required. I'm pretty sure teachers sit in the teacher's lounge with the same lament about us, but at least they're getting paid. First period of the first day of school, I realized if I'm going to maximize my education this year, I'd better take control. Mr. Lambier, our U.S. government current events teacher, underlines that idea for me in spades. As a junior, I took U.S. history from him and dutifully wrote down everything he said, regurgitated it on tests, and walked away with an A. Since then, however, I've begun reading Lies My Teacher Told Me by James W. Lowen, which tells how the 12 most popular high school history texts are way more interested in making us love our country and revere all the famous historical dudes than they are in getting the facts right. As near as I can tell, Lambier told every lie in the book and added some whoppers of his own. So I'm figuring what's true for history may also be true for government. You may as well know I'm conservative and proud of it, he says. Damn proud of it, in fact. I don't doubt him. He looks plenty proud. Best you know where your information is coming from, he goes on. And though I'm conservative, I'm also open-minded to others' ideas, so feel free to disagree with any political thing I say, but be ready to defend your position, and I'll warn you, I was considered a pretty darned good debater in college. Lambier's hard to take. Wears a suede jacket with those leather patches on the elbows, khakis, a sweater vest, and brown loafers. The man is dapper, and though he says he welcomes political debate, he's known to get pretty surly when he doesn't bring you around to his position, which should make him fun to mess with. We sit in traditional rows in his room, and he loves to walk up and down the aisles with a rubber-tipped pointer as he lectures or asks questions. Lambier is the guy who, by his very existence, taught me the meaning of pontificate. We'll cover the structure and meaning of the Constitution in a matter of weeks, he says. So we can put it in today's context. I'm interested in relevance. He goes on to make clear what a miraculous document our Constitution is and how it has stood the test of time with relatively few changes, amendments, over its more than 200 years in existence. Did you know the framers recommended we revisit the Constitution about every 20 years? I ask. Excuse me? Yeah, they knew that things changed, that the Constitution could get stale in the face of progress. Lambier takes a deep breath. We'll get to questions and discussions later, Mr. Wolf. He turns back to his notes. The Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments to our Constitution, is the perfect example of laws that stand up in any age. He raises his eyebrows at me. I raise my hand at him. Mr. Wolf, I said, I know, but what about the right to bear arms? What about it? Do you think the framers of the Constitution knew that amendment would put semi-automatic weapons in the hands of teenagers like my brother, intent on blowing away their classmates? Cody points a cocked finger at me. Sooner Cowan says, Jesus, Wolf, right to bear arms just means everyone can have a gun. Lambier ignores him. Sooner's not exactly the guy you want on your side when trying to make an intellectual point. Do you believe the Second Amendment to be a bad one, Mr. Wolf? It was meant to arm a well-regulated militia, I say. I think it needs to be more exclusive. If we take away one's person rights to own a certain gun, he says, where does it end? Have you read Outgunned by Brown and Abel? I ask. This reading binge is turning me into a force to be dealt with. That's a liberally biased piece of... That book has an agenda, he says. It's an outright attack on the National Rifle Association. I start to answer, but he says, hold that thought. We'll come back to this. Let's back up one amendment, I say. Do you subscribe to the concept of separation of church and state? I say subscribe to. Whew, I might have to get leather patches on the elbows of my jacket. Well, first I'd have to get a jacket. Yes, I do, but I also know that our nation was founded by Christians as a Christian nation, so that concept bears qualification. Actually, the fact we were founded by mostly Christians is probably a reason to make sure we enforce the separation, I say. That keeps laws fair if we, like, try to hedge to the Christian side of things. Mr. Wolf, what have you been reading? Just a bunch of subversive stuff, I say. Dallas Suzuki says, remind me to get his reading list. I am speechless. I'd walk proud and erect through gunfire for Dallas Suzuki's grocery list. We'll postpone this discussion until we can get through this early material, Lambier says. Back to his notes. In addition to the Bill of Rights, I say, did you know that Under God wasn't part of the Pledge of Allegiance until the early 1950s? Mr. Wolf! It is clear I have begun my quest for truth and constitutional education with a little too much zeal. So I zip it for the rest of the period in order to finish it in class instead of in the office. First game of the year against Meadows Valley, Cody is en fuego. Sooner Cowens, the aforementioned son of Kong, runs the opening kickoff back to their 10, broken loose by a bullet block from Trout's own 123-pound helmet with legs, and Cody fires a perfect rollout pass to Andy Evans on a down and out to the corner of the end zone. We're ahead by one touchdown with 20 seconds gone in the first quarter, and that's as close as Meadows gets. Cody throws for three more, Sooner runs for two, and our sophomores play nearly the entire fourth quarter. I play on all special teams, which in this case is mostly our kickoffs and their punts, so I'm in on about one play in four. By mid-second quarter, I have a little cult following of impossible dreamers in the stands, and I'm thinking this change of career direction was a great idea. Even their coach comes over after the game to ask what spaceship I rode down on. Coach Banks says again, he doesn't know how he's going to keep me out of the starting lineup on defense, but I tell him again to keep me a surprise. Truth is, the less the other teams see me, the tougher it will be to figure me out. My first words ever to Dallas Suzuki. Bad news, conventional jock wisdom says you girls will have to wait. My diagnosis has turned me into a much more forward dude. Dallas looks up from the open econ book next to her food tray where I would be towering over her. Had I the power to tower. She doesn't miss a beat. Wait for what? Us, I say. Jocks, studs. What are we supposed to wait for you jocks, studs, to do? That thing we do. Hatch? She goes back to her book. Well, that didn't go exactly as I planned, so I invite myself to sit across from her. She reads on. Have you thought about your future? She releases an exasperated sigh, closes the book. Have you thought about yours? It's stated as a threat. I have thought about my future plenty because I can think of it all in one thought, but saying that is not going to get Miss Suzuki into my pickup. I have, I tell her, and I see you in it. As a friend or as a pugilist? Actually, I hadn't thought it out that far, I said, nor did I know I had a choice. Tell you what, she says, opening the book again. Let me finish this now and meet me around 7:30 tonight at the Chief. We'll discuss this long wait I'm in for. I walk away from that conversation way further ahead of the game than I dreamed. Let me be sure you understand the level of my good fortune here. Dallas Suzuki is like the best mix you could get of Japanese and Caucasian. She's tall, listed 5'11 in the volleyball program, and you can't even tell if she's beautiful because she doesn't look like any girl you've ever seen. I've attended every Trout high volleyball game for the past 2 years just to see her legs. Her muscular thighs and calves give her hops so major she blocks out the sun if you're on the other side of the net, and the width of her shoulders makes her appear to be dangling from a wire hanger. There's not one part of Miss Dallas Suzuki's face or body that is in any way Miss World, but you put it all together and I'd swim through 500 yards of molten turds to listen to her fart into a paper sack over the telephone. I pirouette out of first lunch. I know who you are. Who am I? You're me. My therapist is a dream lady. She brought me up to speed on your act. Everything in a dream is part of the dreamer. He smiles beatifically, sips wine from what looks like an ancient goblet. I'm you in ways you can't even imagine. But that messes me up, I tell him. That's not the kind of thing I would say or even think. And where'd you get that thing you're drinking out of? How can you be me if you say and do things I don't know about? I don't know, he says. You're the one who said I was you. Yeah, but you agreed. You said you were me in ways I can't imagine. Two very different things. So how's this work? Can I, like, ask you questions? Like, any questions? Any questions, he says. And you'll answer them? If I know the answers. Well, if you're not me, then you have to be like a spirit or a ghost or something, so you should have answers, I say. Who made you an expert on spirits and ghosts? He asks. Look, don't worry about it. I'm here to help. Did Jonah really live inside a whale for a while? It says big fish, not whale. Okay, did Jonah live inside a big fish? Not even a worm lives long inside a big fish. Next question. Did Adam and Eve really live in the Garden of Eden? Why are you getting all biblical on me? He says. Why the history quiz? I'm trying to figure out who you are, really, because in case you didn't know, I'm dying. And if you're even related to who I think you are, that's a hell of a resource. I mean, Jesus, that's like Spanish Jesus. I could get wise beyond my years real quick. Think of the spread I could get in the yearbook. I'm not related to who you think I am, any more than you are, at least. But you know him, right? Do I know Jesus? Who doesn't know Jesus? Or about him, at least? You sure you want to spend your last days getting into a high school yearbook? Maybe not as a major goal, but it wouldn't be a bad fringe benefit. You're worried about how you're going to be remembered. It isn't a question. Yeah, I guess I am. You think that's bad? It is what it is, he says. You wouldn't be the first, but you worry about your legacy and you'll spend all your time trying to create something you have no control over. It's all in good works, my man. It's about influence, about what people do in your name after you're gone. Were you a real guy once? Is that how you know this? I thought you said I was you. Okay, I don't know. Maybe you are, maybe you aren't. Jesus nods. Well, were you? I'm not here to talk about me, he says. I'm here to talk about you. You have so much to do with so little time, as they say. Now see, that could be me. That's kind of what I've been thinking. So you could be me. Hey, I know. What's 243,000 divided by 107? How would you know if my answer is correct? I didn't see you bring a calculator into this dream. Ben, you have a little less than a year. How much of it do you want to spend testing me? He's right. A distant, loud William Tell overture causes Jesus to shove in reverse and back into the darkness. I push the snooze button on my cell phone alarm in hopes I can get in a couple more questions, but he's out of here.